Townsend, and I'm going to give it over to Frank Townsend for our introductions for today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and good morning. This is the second of three presentations about the Panama Canal. And just to give you a heads up, there will be one next week with Joe Wood, who lives in Tallahassee, is coming down, and he will present live here in his presentation. A little bit of background history of what took place. In 2012, the Panama Canal Museum housed itself down in Seminole, Florida, and it was just a private little collection of ex-zonians with their stuff that they thought was worth preserving. Fortunately, in 2012, the collection then became part of the University of Florida and moved physically from Seminole, Florida to over by Smathers Library, where it has flourished thanks to people like Betsy and John Nemmers, who will be our two presenters. So Dr. Betsy Bemis is a curator at the University of Florida with the museum, and her PhD is in art history from the University of Florida. And John Nemmers is also a curator of the collection, and they have the responsibility of archiving and keeping track of all this stuff that shows up. But John literally is the glue that holds this collection together, because I always find myself calling and say, well, call John, he can figure out where it is and help us. So John does a great job in making this thing all happen. And they are going to present, the topic is Panama Canal Perils, Wartime Portrayals of the Canal in Comics, Film, and Fiction. And it's going to be entertaining clips of movies, comic books, recordings of how the canal was portrayed back in World War II. And so some of it will be a little bit humorous, but nevertheless, that will be the presentation that they're going to have. So I'm going to turn this over to John and let him get going.
Thanks so much, Fran. Frank, I appreciate the kind words, and don't undersell your own effort in being part of the glue that makes it all work. The Panama Canal Museum Collection, the University of Florida, is very much a group effort, and it involves a wonderful relationship with a lot of community members, including Frank, who has been one of our major supporters and donors for many, many years. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. I have presented before, and I recognize a couple of faces and names, so it's good to see you again. For those of you who haven't been at one of my talks that I've given in the past as part of the ILR program, I'm the curator of the Panama Canal Museum Collection at the University of Florida. Also, I'll Betsy, if you want to unmute quickly, and you can introduce, just say hi.
Hi. Many of you had to hear me chatting with Frank early on, so thanks for your patience as we caught up. So I'm Betsy. I'm one of the curators for the Panama Canal Museum Collection here at UF, and it's lovely to be here with all of you. I have the great pleasure of working with these amazing things all the time. So I hope you enjoy what we've got for you today.
All right. Okay, great, fantastic. We're thrilled to be able to share our research into the many portrayals of the canal in comics and film and other popular entertainment in and around World War II. Like a pair of ace detectives from the comic books and pulp magazines of yesterday, we really have followed obscure clues, encountered a lot of frustrating dead ends, and uncovered more than we ever expected when we started looking into this. Full disclaimer, we're not film historians, we're not comic book scholars. Although we've done a lot of research on these topics, we're certainly not experts. So, you know, keep that in mind. We're going to move quickly through a lot of content, which we think you'll find entertaining. And we're going to have plenty of time at the end for questions and discussion. So please do hold your questions. I will also note up front that many of the comics and the films, the media that we're going to be sharing with you, they reflect the attitudes and perspectives of the time, of course. So please note that there are depictions of people, particularly Asian people, that are recognized as offensive today. So I just want to state that up front. To set the stage for discussing the canal during wartime, I want to give you a little bit of context, background information. I know you've probably heard of some of this if you've been a part of the other sessions, like the one last week. But just to make sure we're all on the same page, the U.S. started constructing the canal across the Isthmus of Panama starting in 1904, and the canal opened in 1914. The canal zone, which you can see in the greenish map here on the right as the highlighted area, that was a U.S. territory that stretched for about 5 miles on either side of the canal, connecting the Atlantic and the Pacific. The U.S. operated, maintained, and defended the canal until 1999, so basically the entire 20th century. And then the canal was transferred to the Republic of Panama by treaty in 1999. You really can't overstate the strategic importance of the canal in the first half of the 20th century. At a time when the U.S. really had a one ocean navy, which means that our navy wasn't large enough that we could simultaneously defend both sides of the country, both the Atlantic and the Pacific side. And fears of a canal attack had existed since it opened, and they only grew in the 1930s. So I'm going to hand it over to Betsy, and she can take it from there.
So this project began about 2 years ago when we started to work on an exhibit to celebrate the 75th anniversary of the end of World War II. My job in that process is to help our wonderful exhibit staff locate relevant materials. As I was searching through our database, I came across an entry for an article that sounded like it would be a good fit for the exhibit. I typed the author's name into Google, and I discovered that Major Malcolm Wheeler Nicholson was a pretty important and interesting historical figure. Turns out he is the man often credited with printing the very first comic book and thus creating the multi-billion dollar industry that we know and enjoy today. Out of curiosity, I then Googled Panama Canal comic books. In the 1942 number 15 issue, Superman saves the Panama Canal from a plot to blow it up with a bomb. As a joke, I sent John the Superman comic, which is sold for as much as $18,000, and asked if he wanted to purchase it for the collection. Needless to say, he said he did not buy it, but that also wasn't the end of the story. John was also intrigued by the idea of the Panama Canal showing up in comic books, and 2 days after my discovery, he confessed to me that he had spent quite a bit of time looking and had found a few dozen more. Thus, we were down this rabbit hole together, and here we are with you today. There is still much research to be done, but we hope that you will enjoy it as we take you on a little bit of our journey as we uncover just how prevalent the Panama Canal was in popular entertainment during World War II and started to investigate why. We're still finding new titles to add to our lists, but here are some statistics on where we stand. We were actually shocked at how many we found and had numerous conversations discussing how and why the canal came to feature so prominently. As early as 1914, fear about the canal's vulnerability surfaced, and as the danger of World War II was building, the importance of defending the canal swelled alongside its importance to shipping and supporting the Allied war effort. It was impossible to provide defenses for all American targets, but the canal was considered one of the most vital. Many assumed that the Panama Canal would be hit before Hawaii or the Philippines, and the investments made by the government reflect the prioritization of Panama over other areas. Numerous authors and military historians were writing books and articles expressing their concern about the inevitability of war. Many of those writers were directly referencing the canal in their arguments. Among them was Wheeler Nicholson, the comic book publisher who started this all for John and I. So as John continued to locate more comic books, I continued to wonder why someone like Wheeler Nicholson might be interested in the Panama Canal. He became our bridge between the wartime reality facing the Panama Canal and the prevalence of representations we were seeing in comic books and other published materials. Our focus on his presence in both of these worlds has helped us build strong connective tissue. The image that you see in this graphic is taken from his article, The Coming Attack on the Panama Canal, in which he envisioned a coordinated simultaneous attack from both Germany and Japan. Although canal stories can be found across numerous genres, comic books are clearly the leading category as far as quantity. This makes sense because of the quick speed and smaller expense at which they could be made, but those qualities also tend to make people take them less seriously. To counter that common impression, I want to share some more statistics with you. During World War II, the sales of comics were greater than both Time Magazine and Reader's Digest. Sales tripled between 1940 and 1945 and eventually reached over 15 million every month. 44% of men in the Army and 66% of all men in training camp said that they read comics. By 1944, one out of every four magazines the government shipped overseas was a comic book. Their simple composition of text and image made them uniquely approachable and ideal to distill complex subjects. They became an important part of the popular cultural response to the anxieties of war and to the war effort.
Frankly, we were surprised at the sheer number of big names that were involved in creating these canal stories that we were uncovering in our research. From Wheeler Nicholson and other creators of comics, including the creators of Superman, Siegel and Schuster, to Orson Welles, Al Capp, who created Little Abner, of course, and a host of other famous authors and filmmakers and others. As we progressed, we started to notice a trend. So we started charting out the number of canal stories chronologically and discovered that the high point by far in terms of production of comic story, comic books, films, radio, et cetera, was in 1941. Here, for example, you can see the number of comic book stories featuring the canal was highest that year, and also that production was greater in 1939 to 41 than it was in 42 to 45. We think this demonstrates the importance of the canal in US defense, and it indicates to us that the canal was used by creators to share their fear of attack leading up to US involvement in the war, and possibly to sway public opinion towards involvement in the war. In the 1930s, the world was seeing a rise of the Axis powers and an elevated sense of impending danger. In the US, differing opinions of isolationism versus a belief that the US should enter the war are on display through various creative outlets. The Neutrality Acts in the mid-1930s attempted to ensure US separation from the conflict, and isolationism was extremely popular. As a result, creators rarely identified the enemy nations in their stories at this time. Germany and Japan are not mentioned directly, but are referenced through stereotypical names, traits, and representational characters. However, the fear over attack by these real countries that are masked by these thin veils was growing, and we began to see an escalation in references to the danger, and specifically to the canal. In 1937, the first issue of Detective Comics, which is the comic book that would become DC Comics, was published. It was created and published by Wheeler Nicholson's company. We were very interested by the fact that Panama is used as a setting for this Brett Lawton story. The story itself is not related to the war or the canal, really, but it seems like Wheeler Nicholson is intent on keeping Panama in public consciousness. One of the first films we found is based in a 1927 play set in the mainland U.S. For the movie, though, Swing Low, Swing High, the setting was changed to Panama, possibly because of the public perception of Panama as a very exotic and romantic destination. A theme that we will see continue and become exaggerated in the coming years. The plot follows a hairdresser traveling through the canal who misses her ship and gets stranded in Panama. We chose this clip because of the ingenious way that they depict the movement of ships up and down in the locks, and you'll see this with the change in camera angles. This is a really nuanced detail that would have been lost on many viewers, but it's important enough to the filmmakers to include here. Betsy just told me that you may not have heard the sound on that clip. Is that correct? Was anybody hearing sound there? Sorry about that. I'll try and figure out before we play the next clip. We'll try and get that sorted out. But I think as you can see in the clip there, you can see that the director took great care to show the changing elevation of the ship in the lock as the ship was going down, and as Fred McMurray, who's standing up on the side of the lock, his perspective is changing. We will try and get the audio visuals sorted out because we've got a few other clips to show you, and hopefully we'll be able to get the sound working. In the meantime, let's move on to Lieutenant Leeds. This is 1937 May. It's the earliest comic we found where the canal is actually threatened. And it is also in a comic book published by Wheeler Nicholson. It establishes a popular theme that will continue where a hero is dispatched to the canal to stop a sinister plot. And I know the quality here isn't that great, but this is an old comic and there are many copies around. One important thing I also want to mention here is the date timeline for the creation and publication of comic books. Usually they went to stands 2 to 3 months before the cover date, which means that they were probably written 3 to 5 months before the cover date. So the cover date is the date that we'll show you on the slides of the presentation, but just keep in mind that this might have been actually written 3 months, 5 months before this. So here we have an example as Germany and Japan are growing more belligerent. There are increased calls for a second canal to aid defense, as demonstrated by this article, 1939, concerning a proposed Nicaragua canal. And we'll see this topic appear in comics that we'll cover shortly. We're trying to show here a link between what's happening in the real world and what's happening in the comics that we're covering. All right. In this same month, this Model Airplane magazine features a cover that asks, "Will fascists bomb the canal?" Rather than overtly using the Nazi swastika, you see that they use a similar surrogate on the wings of the plane there. The readers, primarily children and young adults probably, would have known that the enemy was intended to be Germany without having to actually specify Germany. In 1939, the immensely popular comic strip detective Dick Tracy is featured in a serial film, Dick Tracy's G-Men. In this film, a mad scientist plots to destroy the canal among other evil acts and is thwarted by Tracy. This is actually one of my favorite discoveries that we made during our research because of this clip, which it looks to me like this was filmed partially in a bathtub, and I just appreciate that. You were able to hear and see that. I tried changing the setting to see if that would work. Did that come through, Betsy?
That worked for me, but anyone definitely, if you're not able to hear it, just let us know. You can leave a message in the chat or let us know. Because these are the best parts. We want to make sure you get the clips. Those are the most fun. And next we're going to have Smash Comics. This is an example of a theme that we saw in which writers and artists included maps to help remind or teach the audience where Panama is. So we also have a written reminder of why the canal is important for the One Ocean Navy. So they're using these cells in the comics as teaching tools. Another element you can see in this example is that although the enemy is an unnamed country, the uniform and the arm gesture are clear references to Germany and the Nazi salute. So in September 1939, Hitler invades Poland and World War II begins. Moving now to 1940, we notice a few popular themes in these early comics that would persist for most of the war. First, there are many stories that portray an average person in uniform, stopping enemies, frequently single-handedly. And U.S. Marine Biff Bannon is a great example of this. And you see in this comic, he's now in Panama. Another very popular theme also represented in this Biff Bannon story is of the secret base, often on nearby islands near the canal or hidden in the jungles of Panama. In this story, Biff uncovers a hidden submarine canal built somehow secretly right beside the real Panama Canal and covered with a camouflage canvas. Note again how the unidentified enemy has a symbol on his hat that is reminiscent of the swastika. Charlie Chan was a fictional police detective from Honolulu, created for a series of mystery novels and loosely based on a real Chinese American detective. Although the depiction by white actors in the film adaptations are certainly problematic by today's standards, Chan was conceived as a positive alternative to the Asian stereotypes and exaggerated villains that were commonplace at the time. In Charlie Chan in Panama, the story involves an international investigation into a group of travelers that includes one intent on sabotaging the Panama Canal. The opening scene specifically addresses the real-time fear of spies photographing the canal's infrastructure, schedule, and defenses.
Camera studies?
No sabe, senor.
Don't give us that.
Give me that bad stuff.
The film story was likely influenced by the 1938 espionage case in which a number of Germans were charged with photographing canal zone fortifications. So here's another example we're giving of the real world and real life events influencing what we see in popular culture and entertainment.
In mid-June and July, we see the rapid fall of most of Europe. At the same time in comics, we see an increase in the number of red, white, and blue superheroes appearing. This issue of The Shield is one of the first examples of this type of superhero and becomes the recipe or blueprint for many subsequent stories. This is also one of the most complete canal stories that we have, meaning that through the course of this issue, we read about a potential threat of attack, the attack itself, and then the aftermath of repair of the canal. We see the Shield fighting a still unnamed Asian enemy, and they are successful in their attack on the canal. But afterwards, the Shield successfully digs a new canal to save the day. It's interesting to note that they don't replace or repair the existing canal, but they dig a new canal in Nicaragua, which may harken back to the calls for the new canal to be dug as a defense measure, such as the article we saw earlier. Another superhero story from the comics features Phantasmo, who encounters a man who explains he works for the canal, and foreign agents threaten to publish lies about him unless he permits them to take a shipload of thermite into the canal to destroy the locks. Phantasmal arrives at the canal just as the ship captain prepares to ignite the thermite. This is a very popular theme in our stories, unsurprisingly. Enemies are frequently trying to blow up a ship in the locks themselves. Note that we start to see more accurate depictions of the locks, complete with the locomotive engines called mules. And this is true as we proceed later in the next year or two. Phantasmo saves the day, of course, as the heroes usually do. In our research, we continue to find stories that appear to be straight out of the news. Here's an article from 1940 August about Nazi agents operating in Mexico, possibly setting the stage for US invasion from Mexico. And then this espionage story involves a US invasion that starts in the town, then moves to Mexico. This comic has a November date, cover date, which means it was probably created in August or September, exactly as the newspapers were reporting on those spies in Mexico. In this story, the unidentified enemy is Asian rather than German, though. In case you're curious, by the way, the symbol, the person there is Hercules, and that was a popular image of Hercules during the construction of the canal, so that's the harkens back to that. The Submariner, here we have our first real A-list superhero to save the canal. Namor, or Submariner, was extremely popular, and he would go on to have his own comic book series. This story from 1940 in December is interesting for a few reasons. First, the creators appear to be preparing their readers that war is definitely coming. Second, the story involves the successful destruction of a portion of the canal, much like the show story earlier. In this one, though, Namor saves the day by hooking steam shovel scoops to his flying seaplanes and redigging the canal in no time at all. It's interesting to note that the enemy is not really portrayed in this story at all. We'll encounter Namor again several months later, and things are going to be quite different in that respect.
Of the 1941 film South of Panama follows the sister of a government chemist as she and her brother attempt to elude enemy agents who are trying to kidnap him in Panama. He has secret knowledge of a new defense system for the canal. In this clip, he reveals that the new top secret defense element is a camouflage paint they have been using on warplanes and are now ready to use on the canal.
See the planes. That makes it one of our most important military secrets.
Right. Now, we all know how vital it is that we protect the canal, which in case of emergency would be America's first line of defense. Until we have a two-ocean navy, the canal's the only means whereby we can maneuver our present fleet from one ocean to another speedily enough for modern warfare. What would be your plan of action? Just this. Our plan is to paint the locks themselves. An enemy bomber can't bomb what he can't see.
That's true. And you've come at the right moment. We've just completed the installation of bomb nets on several of the locks. With your new paint, it'll make them almost impregnable.
If the paint works as well as we think it's going to, America's canal defenses are going to be the strongest in the world.
You've done a good job, Martin.
Thank you, sir.
Here is another example that the comic industry is not yet directly naming the enemy as Germany or Japan, since the U.S. is not officially at war, but are referencing them through the stereotyped characteristics that John and I have both discussed. In this example, the enemy country is Deucalia, but we can still clearly follow the inference that it is Germany through the visual cues of the Nazi salute and the symbol on the flag and on the uniforms. And this will change soon, as we will see shortly. This is also our first Superman canal story, and it involves a ship loaded with a bomb and a secret submarine, all to be used to blow up the canal. And then, of course, Superman stops the plot and the canal is safe.
So this is not a canal story. We're including it here to show an important change that occurred in comics at this time. Up until 1941, there were mostly those thinly veiled references to Germany and Japan, as we've mentioned. In March 41, though, a new hero appeared in Marvel's Captain America comics number one, and creators put Hitler and the Nazis on the cover. You can't get more overt than that. And soon all of the other comics started following their lead. And here within a few months, we creators started to identify the bad guys and the stories that we were finding involving the canal. And here are just two examples. The one on the left is the first mention of the Nazis, and the one on the right mentions Japan and Hitler, both occurring not too long after the Captain America issue came out. This is one of the most incredible canal images that we found. Here you see Uncle Sam, who in this context is a real superhero with superpowers, not just the country symbol, towering over the canal, fighting off the enemy. This is actually one of two stories we found in which Uncle Sam protects the canal. In this story, the ghost of Theodore Roosevelt, who was the president responsible for the construction of the canal primarily, he appears to Uncle Sam and tells him that the canal needs his protection. And of course, they save the canal.
The attack on Pearl Harbor changes everything. On a macro level, the U.S. enters World War II and the war is irreparably changed. On a micro level, in the comic and other entertainment industries, the event manifests in a number of ways that we'll see over the coming examples. Overt naming of enemies and anger are certainly visible. The attack that everyone has been waiting for has happened, and the target was not the Panama Canal. Although it's slow moving, we do start to see the tides turning in canal stories and how they use the canal to portray specific messaging. This brings us to the war years, 1942 to 1945. This is one of two comic stories we found released in early 1942 about hidden air bases near Panama. These were probably written in October or November 1941 in response to the fireside chat given by President Franklin Roosevelt in September 1941. In the speech, he reveals that, quote, within the past few weeks, the discovery was made of secret air landing fields in Colombia within easy range of the Panama Canal, unquote. We also want to share a reminder of the timeline. So again, although our cover date is February 1942, this is likely written and illustrated in November 41. Because of this, there's no reaction yet to Pearl Harbor, and we'll start to see a creative response to that event in the comic industry in the spring and summer of 1942. And this brings us back to the comic that started it all for us, Superman number 15. And this was probably written in November or December 1941 and hit the stands in January 1942. We're not exactly sure why, but Japan isn't directly referenced despite the trend that Marvel Comics had started with Captain America, as John mentioned. Instead, Superman is still fighting a fictional enemy, in this case, Napkin. So in this story, there are Napkin saboteurs and spies all over South America, especially Panama. And Superman unmasks them all and foils their plot to blow up a ship in the canal. In the film Across the Pacific, Rick Leland, an ex-army captain played by Humphrey Bogart, befriends a professor, Dr. Lorenz, played by Sidney Greenstreet. Lorenz agrees to pay Leland for information about the military installations of the canal defenses. It is ultimately revealed that Leland is a secret agent and Lorenz a known enemy spy. His plan is to destroy the canal with a torpedo bomber. Of course, Bogey eventually foils the plot and saves the day. This clip is set in Panama, and the two men are finally getting down to the specifics of their deal.
Ice water, room 24, please. Well, Doc, what's on your mind?
Now that we're in Panama, I think it's time you began to earn your money.
Okay, Doc, where do we begin?
Pedro Miguel Lux will be a good place for starter. How many batteries are there? What are their caliber?
Anti-aircraft or heavy stuff?
Begin with the 16-inch guns.
Now, let's see. The last time I was down here 2 years ago, there were double railway guns east and west, two twin concrete embrasures half a mile to the north, one four-gun turret of shore-mounted navies back of Hill 14. But what's the idea? You know all that already. Testing me, eh?
You examine the money I gave you.
That's right. Do we go on?
We go on. What specific knowledge have you of the military plane patrol over the canal area?
Well, 2 years ago...
What happened 2 years ago doesn't interest me. What I want is the current schedule of the patrol planes, when the flights take off, exactly what areas they cover, what altitude they conduct their reconnaissance, and the precise time of their return. Ice water, sir.
It's not until late spring, early summer that we start to see the real reaction to Pearl Harbor in comics and other popular entertainment. So here we have a Submariner story. Naturally, there's a lot of anger. You compare this story with the earlier one that we had from 1940, in which the enemy was hardly even identified. In this one, Namor basically takes on an entire Japanese fleet single-handedly and kills them all without mercy. These panels are some of the tamer ones in the story, and the Japanese sailors here commit suicide rather than face his wrath. It's interesting this story takes place near Panama and still features the canal, because that demonstrates to us that the fears of a canal attack were still very real. Keep in mind that most experts were sure that any surprise attack would occur at the canal first, but of course it happened at Pearl Harbor. In addition to anger, the other reaction to Pearl Harbor that we see is a sense of duty and patriotism. We discover many stories involving heroes volunteering to serve in the war. In this story, we have one of our few female heroes who organizes an all-female squad. When assigned to canal defense, she states that she isn't content with defense and wants to bring the fight to the Axis powers. Not only does this signal a shift from defense to offense after the U.S. has declared war, it also coincides with the fact that the U.S. was quickly developing a two-ocean navy. While the canal's strategic importance is still a major focus in these stories, now we see that canal defense is portrayed as secondary to striking back against Japan and Germany. In films, we see a similar pattern of Americans joining the war effort, like in this film involving pilot training. The film originally was set in Pensacola, but the filmmakers switched the setting to the canal zone. Here we have some examples, again, where the creators of popular entertainment had real-life sources for their plots. Just as spy rings were being busted in the canal zone, there are numerous examples of spy rings and conspiracies in the comics, films, and other stories. And we close out 1942 with the U.S. and allies fighting in French North Africa. There are distinct theaters of war now, and the real action is happening in Africa and the Pacific and not in the canal zone. The trend we see in canal stories at this time is that creators start to play up the exotic nature of the canal region.
Captain Midnight and the Panama Plot is interesting because it revisits the canal's history with yellow fever and certainly references the idea of Panama's exotic jungle environment. In the story, the Japanese plan to use mosquitoes to infect Americans with yellow fever and are breeding the mosquitoes at a nearby secret base. Now I want to talk to you quickly about a significant change in the public consumption of war information and the use of pop culture as propaganda for a specific war agenda. The Writers War Board was established in 1941 by the Treasury Department to help sell war bonds and eventually evolved into an organization that helped create and disseminate propaganda for the U.S. government and armed services. During their time, they enlisted over 4,000 writers who were sent messages, themes, and ideas to then develop into their own pieces. In 1943, the relationship between the comics industry and the U.S. government became official, and the records of the Writers' War Board indicate that they worked with at least 8 different comic book publishers. Both parties agreed that much could be done in the war effort through comics, and many major publishers submitted story drafts to the Writers' War Board and created new characters and features at their behest. Comics were especially effective for the war effort because they had a large male audience, including soldiers and teenage boys close to draft and enlistment age. Beginning in 1943, both the Army and the Navy started working with comic book publishers to create storylines designed to boost enlistment and encourage participation. Here we see Steve Rogers explaining the importance of the canal to his friend and sometimes sidekick Bucky Barnes. For those of you that don't know, Steve Rogers is Captain America's out-of-costume identity and a man deeply committed to the American military. So here we see them in full regalia racing to save the Panama Canal from enemy forces. Although sadly, this Captain Marvel story does not include a fabulous image of the canal, it does demonstrate for us a few connections to the writer's war board. C.C. Beck, the writer and illustrator of Captain Marvel, was on the war board's comic committee. A second connection is how the comic book publishers collaborated with the military was to promote certain types of service. Note the highlighted word in the far right cell on the screen. You see the words U.S. Gunner are in bold, and this is likely in response to the writer's war board effort to highlight specific jobs that the military needed help recruiting for. In the 1944 film Arsenic and Old Lace, Mortimer Brewster, played by Cary Grant, discovers that his two unwed aunts who run a boarding house have been killing some of their less fortunate male guests. Mortimer's uncle also lives in the house, and because he believes that he is Teddy Roosevelt, the women have been able to convince him that he's digging the Panama Canal and burying yellow fever victims in the basement, when all the while he has been doing away with the evidence of their crimes. This film is a dark and entertaining comedy that prominently features, although never visualizes, the canal.
Find that same piece we would.
Are you poor? You mean he dropped dead right in this chair?
Mm-hmm. Oh. And then you see Teddy came up from digging in Panama and he thought Mr. Midgley was a yellow fever victim. Mm-hmm. And that meant that he had to be buried immediately.
Sure. So?
So we all took him down to Panama and put him in the lock and gave him a decent Christian burial. There. Now, you see, that's why we told you not to bother about it, because we know exactly what's to be done.
So in mid-1944, we've entered the last stages of the war, but we continue to see the canal depicted as a vulnerable target. And the truth is that the canal still was very much a vulnerable target. In fact, Japan had created submarines at this time specifically intended to attack the canal. They never used them because they were on the defense in 44 and 45. Here in this, in the comics, we found another example of a secret hidden jungle base. This time, it's an Aztec temple just outside the canal zone, which if you know your geography, you'll know that that's not very likely. The comic creators certainly like to play up the exotic setting without necessarily doing any fact-checking. So we found stories featuring Aztec ruins, Mayan ruins, headhunters, and a variety of other odd choices. Fortunately, Captain Marvel Jr. is able to thwart an attempt by Germany and Japan to drain the Gatun Lake in the canal. By the way, this story also features a boy superhero, which was another trend in later war years. Many comics feature children as protagonists, which may be tied to the government's efforts to promote the war effort and to encourage enlistment.
This comic offers the most specific connection we have to the Writers' War Board, the comic industry, and Panama Canal story. So this one really hits all of it for us. At this time, helping to shape the peacekeeping operation that would be employed after the war was a primary concern for the War Board. The type of organization that they were hoping for and working towards would eventually become the United Nations. In keeping with their priority, the War Board convinced Fawcett magazines to create a new comic book character, Radar, the International Policeman. Here in our Panama Canal story, we see the canal in danger from a civil war instigated by the Germans. We wish we could show you a clip from this, but unfortunately, Private Snafu, Secrets of the Caribbean was unreleased and is presumed lost. Private Snafu was a character created for a series of short animated training films for the Army. In this particular short, Private Snafu was guarding the Panama Canal. Some famous names associated with Private Snafu are Frank Capra, Chuck Jones, Dr. Seuss, Phil Eastman, and Mel Blanc. And this brings us to the end of the war in Europe in May, and only a few months later to the end of the war in the Pacific as well.
For the sake of time, so we have time for questions and discussion, we're gonna skip a couple of slides here that kind of rehash some of the things we've already talked about. And we're going to, give you one more example here. We found of an example where creators were developing stories based on actual events, and because the canal was in the news so frequently, it was logical to use the canal in their stories. This military themed comic, for example, looks as if the illustrator has just traced this photo straight out of Life magazine you see on the left there.
So as it is probably clear to you, we have really enjoyed this journey and hope to continue working on this project. We are actively collecting examples of Golden Age comics and films for the Panama Canal Museum collection. We're planning a research trip to the Library of Congress and a few other libraries to look at the records of the Writers War Board. So if you enjoyed this, stay tuned as we continue to advance the research and hope to be able to draw even stronger connections between the Panama Canal pop culture industries and the Writers War Board. Thank you so much.
We do have time for questions, comments.
Frank, do you have any comments, anything you want to share?
Well, I want to thank you both for a very entertaining. I particularly like the arsenic and old lace, because when I saw that, I had the chuckle about Teddy Roosevelt burying the bodies down for yellow fever. But it's amazing that the comic books portrayed so much in that particular point in time. And I guess I was a little bit too young to be reading comic books, although in 44, I was 4 years old. Are there any other questions?
I see that Richard has his hand raised. Richard, do you want to go? And then I see Rick, you're up next.
Yeah. Okay. Part of the factual evidence, the Japanese started to develop a airplane hangar on a submarine. So they developed two major submarines to attack the Panama Canal because with the aircraft from launch from a submarine, so they could go underwater during the daytime on their passage to Panama. And then when they got there, luckily, the two the Japanese subs were captured by the American Navy and were really re-engineered and taken apart. But they were actual factual developments in their and the war plan of the Japanese Navy to take submarines that could have a plane or two built into the upper structure of their submarines. And they built two of them that were actually on their way to Panama Canal when they were actually captured.
Thank you very much for that comment. Yes, and as a matter of fact, we have in our Panama Canal Gallery on campus, we have an exhibit right now focusing on World War II, not specifically on popular media and comics and films and things like that, but World War II in general for the canal. And we actually do cover that. We have a book there and with some images of that submarine, which was rather ingenious and was built specifically, as you say, for that one purpose. There is also reports that the Japanese had built mock-ups of the canal in which, you know, they could test these subs against, you know, launching these air attacks from the subs. You're absolutely right. It's a good thing that the Japanese Navy was on its heels at that time, or those might have been used against the canal. Thank you for that comment. Rick?
Okay.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, go ahead. Hey,
thanks. I appreciated your reference to the Writers War Board and its efforts to coordinate propaganda through the media and other industries. So I'm wondering to what degree you found evidence of censorship or self-censorship by the War Board or any government entities before that.
find a lot before the war board, but they definitely, there was a back and forth, and they asked them, there was a constant exchange about asking them to alter how characters were portrayed, certain races or countries, or there was a significant amount of input in back and forth between the war board. But that's an interesting question about how that censorship might have taken place before there was that that unifying body to do so. That's an interesting question. I have not found any evidence of that, but certainly that doesn't mean it didn't happen.
We have plans, as Betsy was saying, we were continuing to do our research, and the pandemic, of course, put a halt in a lot of things we were working on. So, but that's one of the things we want to do, is get up to some of the government records to see both the war board records, but also other government offices, war information office, for example, to see exactly what that relationship was like and what the communication was from the government to comics publishers. And, you know, in particular, that question of, are the comic creators, are the film producers, are they just reacting to what's in the news in some cases, or is the government saying to them, hey, it'd be great if you did a story on the danger of hidden bases, or if you did a story on Japan versus Germany, that kind of thing. That would be very interesting for us to find evidence of that. Thank you for that question. Did we have other questions or comments?
I don't see any other questions, but I'm overwhelmed by the amount of research you've had to do to find all those clips and stuff. That's a real mark of a researcher. Well done, John and Betsy. Well done. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. We'll see you next week.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.